It is so good to have the choir back, isn't it? Wow. They just add something to this service that nothing else could duplicate, nothing. And it's all the Spirit of God actually singing through them to us, including what they just sang, which was a prayer, actually. And may it be our prayer for all of us. Well, good morning. Here we are in the first Sunday of autumn. And I'm going to ask you to indulge me this morning. I'm going to do something I haven't done in 50 years of preaching. I'm actually going to preach from a manuscript. I'm going to read my sermon to you. Now, I don't feel too bad about that because I noticed that the United Nations, all these different world leaders, they got up and they read everything they had to say to the August General Assembly. So if they could do it, I could do it. Of course, they had a teleprompter and all I've got is a telepaper. But be that as it may, you say, well, why are you doing this, David? Well, because God told me to. How's that? That's the main reason. But when I tried to figure out why would he be telling me to do this, I came up with four good reasons. One, make sure I stay in my time limit. When you get the last page, it's over. Number two, because there are some important things I think he wants me to say this morning. I want to be sure they all get said, and this is the best way to ensure that. Number three, this manuscript will be available to you if you want to go back and study some of the things I'm about to share with you. All you do is go to the church's website, thecornernj.com, and at the very top it says services/prayer. Just click on that, and this manuscript will be there for you, and you can take it and maybe think through some things that you missed as we went through it this morning. But I think the main reason why he's asked me to do this, something I've never done in 50 years, it's because there's some parts of this that are so emotional for me that I don't think I'd get through it if I wasn't reading it. So, you see the picture up on the screen? That's a long bridge into the sunrise. And I thought that really captures what I'm giving as the title of my message this morning. And the title is simply this, Our 2023 Journey Together from Grief to Glory, from Consecration to Consummation. Okay, you ready? Here we go. Since Palm Sunday, we've been on quite a journey together these past few months. It reminds me of that funny story of the teenage mosquito who got permission to explore the neighborhood for the very first time. And so he flitted from yard to yard and porch to porch and barbecue to barbecue. And in the evening when he came home and his dad said, well, what did you learn today, son? He said, I just didn't know I was so popular. Everywhere I went, people kept clapping for me. Well, in the same way, for 27 Sundays, as Audrey and I have taken our church on a tour of Scripture to focus on who Christ is as the ultimate fulfillment of our lives, we found ourselves as a congregation applauding for our Lord and Savior over and over as we have discovered so much more of the wonders of who He is and who He is for us. And this is why I believe we can title this totally unexpected but extraordinary journey that we've been traveling together with these four simple words, from grief to glory. To be sure, as our church was hit with one setback after another last April, we underwent an extended season of grieving over what had been lost. This was only natural, but it was not fatal. That's because for Christians, grief is always mixed with hope, as Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 4. Therefore, starting on Palm Sunday, we set our sights on what Scripture describes as Christ in you, the hope of all the glorious things to come. We discovered the true power of Jesus' promise in John 12 when he cried out, and if I be exalted, I will draw all kinds of people to myself. And so we lifted him up week after week until finally, we created what we called a photo album of the heart with 97 separate biblical snapshots of who Christ is today. And we uncovered a vast variety of insights into the greatness and grace of our Redeemer and King, along with the amazing hope we have in Him. Increasingly, what happened to us this summer is what 2 Corinthians 3 promises, where we read these words, as we all contemplate the glory of the Lord Jesus, we are being transformed into that same image from one degree of glory to another degree of glory by the Holy Spirit. In other words, from grief to glory to glory. As this magnificent journey unfolded this summer, however, this one curious experience marked virtually every Sunday morning. No matter who was preaching, no matter what the specific aspect of Jesus' glory we were looking at, we seemed to come under what I would call the weightiness of the manifest presence of Jesus. Did you notice how during the sermons in every worship service, in both traditional and contemporary, there came upon us a holy stillness, a motionlessness, almost a breathlessness? It was as if the entire congregation became one eye, one ear, one mind, one heart. As someone put it to me, it was as if we as one body were glued. Glued, not to the preacher or the message or even the scripture, but glued to Jesus himself. Now, this consistent experience this summer over the months, it reminded me of an event that took place on October 4th, almost 25 years ago. That was the day I invited 1.5 million men who had gathered from every part of the nation onto the Mall in Washington, D.C., to prostrate themselves before our risen, ascended, reigning, victorious, saving Lord Jesus Christ, to worship and focus on him as the ultimate answer to all of our thousands of prayers offered that day for a national spiritual awakening. And they did. Flat, with their faces in the dirt, from one end of the Mall to the other. And then I had us spend a full 3 minutes in absolute silence before our Savior. And as we did, the weightiness of the manifest presence of Jesus came down upon that Mall in sacred stillness. Countless testimonies that I've received over the years since then have verified how during those 3 minutes of just focus on God's Son, the Spirit powerfully moved to permanently transform thousands of believers as we did nothing that day but consecrate ourselves more fully to Christ. During those moments, our Father spoke to me so clearly. He said, David, what you're seeing out there is a picture of the things to come. Immediately, I knew exactly what he was referring to. He was referring to a season just ahead of us, a season of the church when there will be a widespread awakening in this nation to the supremacy of Christ all across the land of such a magnitude that for multitudes, the initial response will be nothing short of total consecration to him. But listen to this. This same kind of encounter is what I've witnessed with this company of Jesus followers here at NPPC these past months. Sunday after Sunday, our Redeemer has been manifestly at work among us, clearly and directly, moving us individually and together from grief to glory. That is why this month, Audrey and I decided to create a 3-part series on the very biblical concept of consecration. That word is our answer to the question I'm sure many of you have, which is, where do we go from here? What do we do with this grander, more glorious vision of Jesus that God has given us during this journey? And that brings me to today's key passage on consecration, 2 Corinthians 11, verses 2 to 4. You'll see it on the screen. Let me read it to you. Paul writes, I am jealous for you with godly jealousy, because I promised you to one husband, to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. But I'm afraid that just as the serpent deceived Eve by his treachery, your minds may be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. For if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus different from the one we proclaimed, or if you receive a different spirit than the one you received, or a different gospel than the one you accepted, you put up with it well enough. Now, my goal in this message is that from this day forward, you will never think of the word consecration without also thinking at the same time of another, a similarly sounding word, consummation. Actually, they're inseparable. And let me show you why. Briefly, here's the backstory of this passage. The Corinthian church had divided itself into competing factions around various individuals who Paul called in this chapter, he calls them, quote unquote, super apostles. In other words, the Christians there had become personality driven, which is true of a host of Christians all across our nation right now. Rather than person driven, that is united in a common consecration to Christ alone. And as a result, the church was struggling with all kinds of moral and theological strivings and detours. Now, in the thick of this drama, Paul saw himself as a father, and he saw the Christian community in Corinth, which he had founded. He saw them as his daughter, whom he had promised to Christ as a bride. As father of the bride, therefore, Paul was determined to present her to Christ as pure, no promiscuity, no rivals. He was fighting for her spiritual virginity, to keep this congregation holy, totally, sincerely, wholeheartedly devoted to Christ alone. However, competing agendas were at play in their church. And Paul calls these agendas another or a different Christ and gospel and spirit. Technically, he's not referring to blatant heresy. Rather, he sees these various super apostles bringing teachings and approaches that were diminishing, diluting, defacing, and altogether diverting their vision about Christ over to themselves as spiritual gurus. These so-called apostles were attempting to capture the allegiance of Corinthian Christians for themselves, for their own purposes. Unfortunately, as we read, the believers there appear to be predisposed to follow. And that is why in 2 Corinthians 11 passage, Paul likens any effort that pulls believers away from a laser-focused devotion to Christ as duplicating the strategy that Satan used when he tempted Eve toward the good fruit that God had created, but doing it in a way that would pull her away from God himself. And let's remember, Satan did his work on the inside. He was a resident in Eden when he led our parents to compromise obedience to their creator. In the same way, the challenge to the Corinthians' unwavering commitment to Christ, it was coming from teachers inside the fellowship of believers. And note this as well. This can happen inside any church today, even here. For example, we see this today, especially when the trappings of Christianity and churchianity begin to clutter and encumber and clog up and compete with our discovering more about Christ, experiencing more of Christ, becoming more like Christ, giving more of ourselves for Christ. For example, leaders like Tim Keller warn, even with a Bible study, our top priority and approach must be to come to Scripture to let it enlarge our vision of Christ and increase our hope and passion toward Him. Otherwise, even after hearing years of sermons, believers can still end up with another Christ and another gospel. In the same way, the church community can have all of its ducks in order. It can have a well-oiled organization, productive committees, as well as fully staffed and funded programs to meet every age and every need, and still find itself, to paraphrase from Romans 10, with a knowledge of Christian-related issues, but with little encounter with the power and person of Christ himself. This is why Paul calls himself a jealous father. Regarding this Corinthian congregation, not jealous of them, but jealous for them, with a jealousy, he says, that comes right out of the heart of God. Paul sought to ensure that the bride-to-be would stay faithful to the one she's about to wed. Jesus was to be her singular concern, her magnificent obsession. In other words, what Paul wrote in Galatians 2, he wanted for Corinthian Christians as well. when he said, you have no life of your own, now Christ is living in you, and the life you now live in the flesh, you live by faith in the Son of God who loved you and gave himself for you. Or couldn't you hear Paul calling the body of Christ in Corinth to follow his own example as he writes about it in Philippians 3, urging them, count everything else in your life as a loss in comparison to knowing Christ Jesus our Lord and being found in him. Now let me be candid with you. It is at this point that the church, capital C, the church, in our nation, finds itself enveloped in a sobering crisis. I've observed in my decades of traveling into every stream of the body of Christ, and for years, I've been calling it a crisis of Christology. The crisis consists of the significant shortfall among a host of Christians, and there's all kinds of research to bear this out. Significant shortfall in how we see, seek, savor, and speak of Christ for all that he is in the fullness of his supremacy. For sure, this crisis lies at the root of an ominous phenomenon that research is now unveiling and has just been published this month, and the researchers are now calling it the Great Dechurching. Historically, America has experienced great awakenings, but we're currently undergoing the very opposite, what now is being called the Great Dechurching. In fact, we're told on the first page of a book that just came out 2 weeks ago with that as its title. This is just page one. As they begin to present the research, they write, America is currently experiencing the largest and fastest religious shift in the history of our country as tens of millions of formerly regular Christian worshipers nationwide have decided they no longer desire to attend church at all. These are what we now call the dechurched. Over the past 20 years alone, 40 million adults in America today who used to go to church do so no longer. This is not a gradual shift. It is a jolting one. So, brothers and sisters, never has the call to consecration to Christ for all that he is been more critical than it is at this very hour. How desperately we need to experience a strong dose of what Paul calls godly jealousy. We need it now. We need it here. And that brings me back to the synonym I mentioned about for consecration, and that's that other word, consummation. Now, you've probably heard this word before because it's often used to define the end of history when the redemptive purposes of God are consummated and Jesus reigns in the day of our resurrection over a new heaven and new earth. And you might call that our eternal wedding day, or as it says in Revelation 19, it's the marriage supper of the Lamb. At that point, our engagement, that is, our betrothal to Jesus, will reach its fulfillment in its entirety. But before then, there are two major approximations of that consummation that the betrothed, that's you and me as Jesus followers, are invited to enjoy right now. And both of them are about consecration. The first form is a consecration to Christ, where we are constantly consuming more and more of him in the fullness of life we have in him. You know, Jesus put it this way in John 6. He invited us to feast on him, which, again, it wasn't some kind of grotesque cannibalistic way, but rather he was inviting us to open ourselves to the Spirit of God for him to nourish our souls daily so that we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Day after day, our intentional prayer must sound like this paraphrase of Psalm 2. Father, as the deer pants for water, so I thirst for your Son, my reigning Savior. I long to know all that you have for me in him and for in him as life ever knew. By your Spirit, help me find more of him so I might abide more deeply in him, drawing on the riches of your promises to us in him. You know, we've done a lot of that these past few months, haven't we? However, secondly, even more true is that consecration happens to us as we increasingly are consumed by Christ. As Paul puts it in 2 Corinthians 5, he said, Christ died for us, therefore all of us were dead, and he died for us so that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. Or as Jesus put it quite succinctly in Mark 8, to paraphrase, to experience what real life is all about, we must lose our lives for. That is, we must become consumed by everything that revolves around the person and cause of Christ. You see, it's not so much the joy of following Jesus is to have him at the center of who we are and where we're headed, what we're doing, how we get blessed. No, the joy of following Jesus is for us to get at the center of who he is, where he's headed, what he's doing, and how he gets blessed. And bottom line, this is a Trinitarian transaction. It involves the three persons of the Godhead. The Father gives the Son to us and all that comes with him. The Spirit gives us to the Son and all that comes with us. And then we give the Son the supremacy in everything with heart and mind and soul and strength, consumed by him to the glory of the triune God. Thus you see, consecration consisting of pure, undistracted devotion to Christ becomes consummation. We consume him, he consumes us. And remember this, one day all creation will join us and all the redeemed in a glorious celebration that will be the consummation when everything is consuming Christ and everything is consumed by him as Lord of all for all the ages to come. So how do we keep moving in this direction? Individually and as a congregation of God's people. And there's only one answer to that question. We must keep on doing what we have been doing these past few months. But not just in our Sunday services. In our Sunday schools, in our youth groups, at committee meetings, in our deacons' ministries, around our dinner tables, in your own private prayer times, we must keep on making much of Jesus to one another all the time. Remember how he commended one disciple for choosing to sit at his feet in order to know him better? And he said it would not be taken away from her. Well, it's the same for us. This must not be taken away from us either. Scripture proclaims to all believers that whatever we do in word or deed, we are to do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bottom line, all of life, true life, is all about him alone. So let me ask you, how do you think the New Testament church exploded upon the Roman Empire so powerfully in its first few decades, as we see recorded in the book of Acts? I mean, they had no Bibles as we do. They had no trained seminarians to teach them. They had no Sunday school classes, no midweek Bible studies, no religious television shows, no YouTube worship videos to encourage them. But what they did have is precisely what we have as well. To paraphrase Colossians 3:16, they made sure the truths about the glories of God's Son saturated their life together as they themselves taught and encouraged one another with all that they were discovering as they walked with Christ day by day. You see, Paul really believed what he prayed to the Father in Ephesians 3, that the Holy Spirit would work directly in believers anywhere, helping them swim deeply, as it were, into the depths of Christ and his powerful love, being filled with more and more of the life in Christ beyond what one might ask or think. Do we believe what that New Testament church believed? Maybe more to the point, do we want this kind of relationship with God's Son, where our consecration to him becomes our consummation in him? For sure, these past months, we've gone from grief to glory. Now, are we ready to go from glory into more glory? Are we ready to pursue more of Christ? More of who he is to us and for us? More of who he is over us and before us? More of who he is within us and through us? More of who he is coming upon us? My strong sense is that our NP Peace family truly is ready for this. In my 32 years among you, I have never sensed that fact more than I do right now. Brothers and sisters, This is not a work of the flesh. This is a work of the Spirit of God. And it's a foretaste of all that waits for us just ahead. Let me close by opening one more window onto my soul. A week ago, I was hiking through the woods and open fields at the Somerset Environmental Center, reflecting on all that we've discovered about Christ this summer and praying for all of you. And suddenly, unexpectedly, I was overtaken, almost swallowed up by the presence of Jesus. And standing there alone among the trees, I heard myself cry out to my utter shock, "Lord Jesus, I want to be totally consumed with you and by you right now." The fact is, it seemed that that was exactly what was happening to me. It was such a holy moment. To be honest, I wept uncontrollably for a few minutes. However, soon after I got back to my office, I recalled reading years ago an entry by Jonathan Edwards in his diary in 1737. Now, at the time, Jonathan Edwards was the pastor of the second largest church in all of New England, a biblical scholar, and a leader in what historians have come to call the first great awakening in America. Now, if anyone knew about Jesus, Jonathan Edwards knew about Jesus. But even so, in his diary, he recorded an amazing event that took place one afternoon when he took a break to enjoy a horseback ride into the woods near Northampton. There he experienced something similar to what I did that afternoon. So using Google, I was able really quickly to locate this very famous paragraph. And now I want to close by sharing it with you. Why? Because in essence and in principle, this describes what I believe the Father wants for every Jesus follower, for each of us, for our congregation, for God's people all across this land in this dark hour. And here's what Edwards writes. "Once I rode out into the woods for my health in 1737, having alighted from my horse in a retired place, as my manner commonly has been. And I had a view that was for me extraordinary. I saw the glory of the Son of God as mediator between God and man. The person of Christ appeared ineffably excellent, with an excellency great enough to swallow up all thought and conception. This continued, as near as I could judge, for about an hour. And I felt an ardency of soul to be what I know not otherwise how to express, but emptied and annihilated. I wanted to lie in the dust and to be full of Christ alone, to love him with a holy and pure love, to trust in him, to live upon him, to serve and follow him, and to be fully consecrated to him with a divine and heavenly purity." Consecration, consummation, or as Edwards put it, full of Christ alone. May this become increasingly for all of us our testimony too. In view of who Jesus is, as we've seen this summer, how could any of us settle for anything less? Again, I'm going to do something now that I've probably only done twice in 50 years. I want to end in a prayer, but I'm going to sing it to you. It's actually an old gospel hymn, but you've probably never heard it, most of you anyway. But it's just the perfect way to end. So pray with me. Not I, but Christ, be honored, loved, exalted. Not I, but Christ, be seen, be known, be heard. Not I, but Christ, in every look and action. Not I, but Christ, in every thought and word. Oh, to be saved from myself, dear Lord, Oh, to be lost in thee. Oh, that it may be no more I, but Christ who lives in me. Would you sing with me that chorus line by line? Let me sing it and you repeat it after me. Oh, to be saved from myself, dear Lord. Oh, to be lost in thee.
Oh, to be lost in thee.
Oh, that it may be no more I.
Oh, that it may be no more I.
But Christ who lives in me. May it be done. Would you stand and we'll share this benediction one last time, a benediction of consecration, as we put the benediction on top of each other. We're blessing each other. Would you join me? May God Himself, the God of peace, consecrate you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen. God bless you.